So dealing with errors is easy in C++. First of all, before we go on and understand the C++ concept, I want you to list some typical errors that may happen, that you can think of, that may happen in C and potentially in C++. And this is the first task. And secondly, how do you programmatically deal with errors? How could you think you could do it? How did you do it in C? Pause now the video and I will count down. 3, 2, 1, 0. So here is now a potential way of dealing with errors. Of course, why do we deal with errors? Errors reported by a function must be dealt with because our code may encounter exceptional states. For example, a function may not be able to perform certain operation properly or accurately. So we would normally say an error is considered to be an exceptional circumstance because this function should normally succeed. Yeah, you expect when you try to open a file that the default is you can open the file, but you should handle the case where a file cannot be opened because a directory doesn't exist or so on. Additional errors might be out of bounds error subscripts. You try to divide by zero. You try to provide invalid arguments to a function due to user input and so on. There are many types of errors that we try to cover, and it's very bad coding if you ignore a potential error. Yeah, because at some time, someone trying to execute your code, such an error will occur, and that's still the problem of many products, Microsoft and so on, that exceptions are not dealt with in all cases. So it's sometimes for programmers difficult to handle errors properly, particularly when you ignore an error, it may cause follow-up errors that are hard to spot. For example, you try to dereference a null pointer, try to access such a null object which has been created, but it should have aborted long before when you try to create such an object in the first place. And yeah, so many software companies still harden software at the customer. I think it's smarter and it saves a lot of debugging time by considering edge cases and encoding them in your source initially. So the question is, how can we handle errors in C++? So in C++, we have the following strategies for dealing with errors. First of all, we can ignore a potential error, which we said is bad practice, so don't do that. Next, we could deal with an error immediately at the place where it occurs. That's very good when you deal with critical errors that lead to termination of a program, for example. So you say to a user, sorry, can't do that, exit my program. It's also very easy to spot if proper error checking is implemented in the code, because the errors occur can be checked immediately after they have occurred. However, sometimes what we want to do is we want to deal with errors more gracefully, trying to recover from the situation. So one way of doing that is that we try to prevent or catch the errors long before an erroneous state is reached, so before they are triggered. For example, this is useful when a user inputs data and you say, do you check this data, if this data makes sense? Like, user, please provide the number you try to divide by. I want to divide by zero. Then you could print immediately, sorry, this input is not allowed, instead of trying to execute this division and then print in the user or aborting the program because you have a division by zero. So we try to catch the error before we cause the situation that will be erroneous. The next step is delegation, another option that allows us to escalate the errors to a calling function. Sometimes I cause an error, is an error happened. So like, I cannot open this file, but I don't know what to do, right? I don't know if that is critical or not. Maybe the situation can be remedied. Maybe it's crucial. So who knows better than the function that calls me? So that's the idea. We delegate the error handling to our callee, and maybe they know how to handle it. One warning here, you should never exploit error handling for program control. Yeah, like you should instead, error handling should remain for exceptions. Particularly because errors are not optimized and harm performance of your program. So let's look at how we dealt with errors in C. So how there were several ways of error handling. First of all, a function may return an integer which indicates if an error occurred, and we saw that the standard library uses the ErNo, which is kind of a thread local variable that reports the exact error type. The problem is that the escalation of errors is cumbersome and repetitive. So we have something like func2. If return is not 0, we have to try to handle the error, we return 1, trying possibly to set ErNo to appropriate value and so on. So decoding of the exact error type is also annoying because the error type is encoded in just an integer. Some functions need special errors. So a typical function that we see that escalates is able to escalate errors is really this pattern. We have a function that returns integer, and this integer is just there to indicate an error state. So 0 means no error, 1 means there is an error. Yeah, and this ErNo function could be set in the standard library in this code over here. So in C++, we have, however, constructs for clear exception handling that allow us to make more clear, robust, fault-tolerant programs. But these exceptions, they are very slow, so they should be used only for exceptional circumstances. It also allows to remove error handling code from mainline execution of the program. So how does this work? Well, errors now throw an object that allows us to invoke code on an exceptional path. What we need to know is new keywords: try, catch, throw, and no except. Let's have a look at general pattern for catching errors. We try here to run the code that is inside this code block, which could be dangerous, so it may throw an exception. If it doesn't throw anything, we would run this code as usual and then finish after the try block, executing the next statement. So it's just a sequential execution. However, if there was an error occurring and it's of a certain type, here it's out of range, for example, object that has been thrown, then I deal with the error in this block over here. And if a function doesn't deal with an error that is thrown, then it's escalated to the calling method or function until someone catches the exception. And if nobody catches the exception, then your program will terminate. But hopefully you handle errors. There is in C++ a class hierarchy of errors derived from each other, and they start from this type exception class over here, the list over here. So it allows you to conveniently provide messages for errors and the type of error. So how do we throw an exception? So the throw keyword indicates an exception has occurred. It has one operand. That means you can provide a data type. If the operand is an object, we call it an exception object. Otherwise, it's just a value. So let's have a look. So we say if the denominator, for example, of our division is 0, then we throw the divide by 0 exception. So this here is now constructed an object, divide by 0 exception object in particular. And this object then is returned as an exception by using the throw keyword. So that means at this point, my code will terminate, and it then is caught by the closest exception handler around, unwinding the stack in this process. We will look at that. So in an example, but how do we catch an exception? Well, we use this catch blocks. In this catch block, we can specify the exception type and give it a name, a parameter name, and then we pull inside such a block, we ha put down the code to handle an exception. So this code here is only triggered if the argument type matches the throw type. Often people use const references in the exception type because, well, it's a bit more to write, but more efficient and clear. Example is here. We try to catch and divide by 0 exception into the variable x, and then we print out a message: exception occurred x dot what. What is a function provided by this exception class that indicates the reason for it. So it's an explanatory string, allowing you to analyze the cause of error. Maybe you want to print this out in a log file or give it to the user. So here's now an example how multiple errors can be dealt with. And we have here a try block and try to execute this potentially dangerous operation. Then we have a catch, we try an out of range error. So if there's an out of range object being thrown, we deal with it in this block over here, trying to deal with it gracefully. But if there's some other exception, we may want to do something more drastic, trying to do some cleanup first, and then we throw the object again. So you can re-throw basically an exception object if you don't know how to handle it. But if it's any other exception, remember this is a generic type, then we can say this is a critical error, we have to abort the program, calling the exit kind of function. So semantically, a function can throw an exception object if it detects an error. Objects may include a character string, which is the error message. They may be just being strings, the error message itself. But more lately, I would say class objects are used that encapsulate the behavior and the cause for errors. So if the exception handler exists, the exception will get caught and handled, otherwise the program terminates. So how do you handle errors in your code? Well, you have to enclose the code that may have trigger an exception in a try block, followed with one or more catch blocks. Each catch blocks indicate the exception handler, the type to handle that you try to, that could occur. And if the exception occurs and matches the parameters in the catch block, the code of the catch block is executed. It always executes the first catch block where the argument matches. So that's why in this case I had more specific errors in the catch block first, and then the more generic type, exception type, at last. Because that, if I don't know what kind of error it is, well, I kind of throw this error. If no exception is thrown, well, all the exception handlers are skipped, our catch blocks are skipped, and the control resumes after the catch block. Right, we say there is a throw point, which is the place where an exception occurs, and the control can never return to a throw point. It's really trying to go back. So any function is assumed to throw an exception. There is an exception to this rule, which is functions that are annotated with the no accept attribute. So if I have here a func that takes an I as an argument, I can state here with an attribute no accept or this keyboard that this function will never kind of create an exception. If such a function throws an exception, it typically terminates the program. And I want to mention that prior to C++ 20 standard, you could annotate functions with a list of exceptions thrown, but this was very cumbersome and it's now called deprecated, which means you should not use this anymore as it may go away in future revisions of C++.